Hi, my name is David McCraw. I'm Assistant General Counsel at the New York Times Company. And thank you to Columbia for sponsoring this, and thank you all for coming out. This panel, as you know from the schedule, looks at American and Canadian developments in law. It's a little intimidating because there are so many people in the room who know so much about those topics, maybe not Canada, but certainly the United States. So we're going to try to do this as a bit of a conversation. Each of the speakers, or each panelist, is going to speak briefly, 6 to 8 minutes, about cases of interest to them. We'll then have a discussion, invite you into that discussion. A couple of just preliminary remarks, though, before I introduce the panel, that as Steve said at the last panel, First Amendment jurisprudence is a disastrous mess. So we're not going to try to either straighten out the mess or end the disaster. Instead, what we did, I asked the panelists to identify cases they thought were interesting and important that had happened over the last year or so to address that. So it's going to be a bit of a potpourri. Now, what came back when I asked people to identify that was there was a program I noticed very heavily tilted towards offensive speech, threats, and outlandish attacks on people's privacy. So for those of you who will not be at Donald Trump's rally tonight, we're going to cover all of the same sort of things here. The other thing you heard at the last panel was that Denmark is not the 51st state. We will, over the course of this, lose sight of Canada and we'll treat it as the 51st state. And so I'll try to pull back and have Paul remind us about the things going on in Canada. I'm very fortunate to have on the panel today some people who have interesting things to say about free expression in North America. On the far left is Dave Schulz from Yale Law School, and Levine Sullivan, coach in Schulz, and somebody well known to all of us who litigate in the press freedom area. Paul Schabas, who's with the Blake's Law Firm in Toronto. Again, somebody very familiar to those of us who have press freedom problems in Canada. Lynn Oberlander, General Counsel at First Look Media, publisher of Intercept and other online publications. To my right is David Post, formerly professor of law at Temple University. And on the far right, ironically, from the ACLU, is Esha, Bhandari, who has been working with their free expression initiatives. So with that, the scope of this is really, I think you'll see as we talk about very, very diverse pieces of legislation, litigation, is just the vitality of the debate over speech that's taking place in Canada and the United States. Terrorism, privacy, divisive speech, huge issues driving the jurisprudence here. And so what you'll see here over the course of the initial presentations and drawing you into the conversation, we're really talking about free expression in sort of the whole spectrum, because we're going to talk about the right to obtain information as a First Amendment right in the United States. We're going to talk more classically about the right to express facts, opinions, points of view in a variety of areas, including the areas of threatening speech, privacy, terrorism, and in terms of slurs against minorities, or at least things that are perceived that way. And finally, kind of sitting in that mix is the right to be anonymous online and the right of anonymity as one strand of the free expression right. So with that, as I said, each speaker is going to take 6 or 8 minutes to talk a little bit about what cases they've found interesting, and then we will turn it into a more general discussion. So, Esha, if you please.
Thank you very much. I'm going to address 3 significant decisions from the last year, 2 which implicate the government speech doctrine and the potential expansion of that, and then the 3rd case relating to online speech. The first case I'm going to talk about is Walker v. Texas, the case out of the U.S. Supreme Court in June this past year. This case involved a challenge to Texas specialty license plate scheme, which allows for special groups to design their own license plate which would then, you know, say Texas on it, you know, but have their own design and their own message. And the Sons of Confederate Veterans had their license plate application rejected on the grounds that many members of the public would find the message of the Confederate veterans offensive. And they raised a First Amendment challenge. In the Supreme Court's decision, the Supreme Court essentially said the license plate scheme is permissible because it constitutes government speech, such that there's no First Amendment concern from this from the free speech clause. Now, there might be separate concerns relating to the establishment clause if the government were promoting certain messages, but in this case, the court said because the license plate is a form that's historically associated with the government, because the designs remain within the control of the government, and because the public would largely associate the message with the government, this constitutes government speech overall, and therefore there's no First Amendment free speech claim. This decision will, you know, end all of the litigation that has been percolating regarding license plate schemes. Many states have these to raise money. A lot of the debate happened over the abortion messaging that, you know, certain states would allow pro-choice messages, other states would only allow pro-life messages. So a lot of the litigation that led to this decision over license plates was in that context. So that was Walker. And notably, the dissenting opinion in that case, which was authored by Justice Alito and joined by Justices Roberts, Scalia, and Kennedy, pointed out that the danger of the majority opinion would be that the government speech doctrine would bleed into different forums. So, for example, a campus billboard that is provided by the university that contains partial messages from the university, but is obviously meant as a forum for private individual speech, could be swallowed up by this notion that, you know, it's all government speech because it is associated with the government, and therefore the government can engage in viewpoint discrimination and selectively choose which messages. The second notable decision comes from the Federal Circuit Court of Appeals, which was sitting en banc in December 2015 in Re Tam. And this is an interesting case because it was a challenge to the Lanham Act, which is the federal trademark registration scheme. And the Lanham Act essentially operates to allow people who have trademarks to register those trademarks with the federal government. And registering in this way gives you a host of substantive and procedural benefits, including the ability to enforce your trademark in federal court, to, you know, work with U.S. Customs and Border Protection, to have protection for goods bearing your trademark, and so forth. So, in essence, it's a registration scheme on top of the common law protection for trademark. And the Lanham Act contains an interesting provision in Section 2A, which says that trademarks can be denied or revoked on the basis of being either scandalous, immoral, or disparaging. So the challenge in this case was brought by a band called The Slants, and they're composed of Asian American individuals. They're a dance rock band in Portland. And they were denied their trademark registration because the examining attorney at the Patent and Trademark Office said that the term slants, when used by Asian Americans, could only be understood as a slur, and a substantial composite of the public would find that disparaging. So with that factual predicate, the case made its way up to the Federal Circuit, which normally deals with intellectual property issues and is the specialty federal appeals court that deals with trademark. So they're not often deciding First Amendment cases. And in fact, a decades earlier decision in Ray McGinley had seemed to settle the question by saying that the scandalous and moral disparaging provision wasn't subject to a First Amendment challenge. And so the initial panel decision found that there was no First Amendment claim that could be sustained. But the Federal Circuit decided to sit en banc and heard the case and ultimately resolved that the disparagement clause constitutes government viewpoint discrimination. And it specifically dealt with a few of the government's arguments, namely one, trademarks are just commercial speech and therefore entitled to a lower level of protection. And the Federal Circuit found that trademarks do in fact serve an expressive purpose, as demonstrated by the Slants, who chose their name to reclaim a slur used against the Asian American community. and many trademarks of organizations, for example, that serve to both express a message and to be a source identifier. The second important thing that the appellate court said was, it doesn't have to be a complete ban on the use of the trademark to implicate the First Amendment, because the slants remain free to use their name, and in fact, they could get common law protection for their trademark, but what the government's doing is creating a bundle of benefits and conditioning the receipt of those benefits on a viewpoint that the government agrees with. So the appellate court was very concerned with this notion that, even if it's not an outright ban, the use of the trademark, the government could incentivize people to use trademarks with a viewpoint that it agrees with. The most interesting thing here is the government raised a government speech argument and said, because we register trademarks, we are associated with the trademarks in a way that this shouldn't be entitled to First Amendment protection, because we can engage in viewpoint discrimination. If we, issue a certificate registering the trademark, that trademark comes within the auspices of government speech. And the federal appeals court rejected that argument. This case will almost inevitably go to the Supreme Court because it involves a federal statute that was struck down. The cert petition period is still pending, so we'll see what happens there, but it's not the final word. And then the last case I'll mention is the Alonis case, which was decided by the Supreme Court. And that case involved an individual who was convicted for self-styled rap lyrics on his Facebook page. And the lyrics refer to his ex-wife and his children and include vulgar, offensive, threatening language. But he was convicted on a negligence standard. In other words, the jury was instructed that if a reasonable person would see that these lyrics or these statements as threatening rather than lyrics, as he said, he could be convicted that would satisfy the intent requirement. And the Supreme Court set aside the First Amendment issues and said that at least a knowledge or specific intent requirement is necessary. It left open the question of whether you could be reckless, namely if posts on social media that you made with a reckless disregard for whether the audience would consider it threatening, that might allow for conviction under this federal statute. So, the majority didn't deal with the First Amendment implications, although, an amicus brief, many amicus briefs did raise that and said that particularly in the context of social media, if you don't use a subjective intent standard in considering what is a true threat, and in fact rely on the reasonable person standard, there can be a lot of ambiguity about that because the audience is not always clear, the context is not clear as well when you're talking about a potential audience of the world. None of those issues were dealt with. Those have been left for another day.
Thanks so much. We'll move to another aspect of internet speech and in some ways sort of the reverse of what that case dealt with, and that is the right to remain anonymous and some laws that are attacking that particular cornerstone of what has been First Amendment jurisprudence. So, David Post.
Thanks. So it's hard to 6 to 8 minutes. You have to pick a topic that's sort of big enough so that it's worthy of getting 20% of the podium, but not so big that you can't explain it in 6 to 8 minutes. So free speech law in this country has a long and mostly honorable tradition, whereby a great deal of important doctrine was made because courts were willing to stand up and defend the rights of the free speech rights of despised minority groups. Socialists and anarchists in the early part of the 20th century, the Jehovah's Witnesses in the years before World War II, Freedom Riders, and the American Nazi Party in the 1950s and 1960s. That's the way it works. The majoritarian political processes impose these disabilities on despised groups, and then the courts push back. And no group in American society today is as reviled or easier for politicians to impose disabilities on than the sex offenders, people on the National Sex Offender Registry database. 800,000, very briefly, 800,000 people are now on the database, convicted and have served their sentences for any sex offense, any crimes involving sexual activity. Some of those people, of course, have done truly terrible things, rape and violent assault and child molestation, et cetera. Many of them have done much less terrible things. A quarter of the people on the registry are there for crimes committed while they were juveniles. They are on the registry, by the way, in most states for life. So a 16-year-old having consensual sex with another 16-year-old can find him or herself on the sex offender registry forever. And other relatively minor transgressions can get you on the registry as well. Public urination, soliciting a prostitute, prostitution, indecent exposure, et cetera. And the First Amendment rights of the people in this category of sex offenders are being trampled upon left and right. The list of speech-related disabilities that have been imposed upon them is chilling. In many states, they can't use public libraries. In many states, they can't use internet social networking sites at all. And the subject of my paper is they have to reveal, in all states actually, of course this is a nationwide requirement, they have to reveal to the police all of their internet identifiers, any usernames, social networking handles, email addresses, et cetera, that they use. They have to reveal those to law enforcement before they use them on the internet, subject to criminal penalties for failing to disclose. And all of this First Amendment stuff, by the way, is the tip of the iceberg. There are other deep and difficult constitutional issues. These people are subject to residency restrictions, employment restrictions, even civil confinement. Congress passed a statute just a couple of months ago requiring each of them to have a special, unique identifier on their passports and to inform the Department of Homeland Security whenever they travel abroad. So constitutional right of travel is implicated, due process clause is implicated, ex post facto, lots, but I'm focused on the anonymity implications here. This has very serious implications, I think, for the rest of us. You don't have to be concerned about sex offenders, or like sex offenders particularly, to be worried about this. People on the registry have the same First Amendment rights that you or I have. They are not prisoners. They are no longer subject to the jurisdiction of corrections. They are technically free. And the doctrine that is emerging from these cases is going to go a long way to defining our rights to use social networking or to speak anonymously on the net. There are about a dozen challenges that have taken place over the last several years. I've summarized them in the paper that I think was distributed to you. In the federal courts, the news is not good. It's actually split about 50-50, courts that have upheld these disclosure requirements and those that have struck them down. And what is even more worrisome is that even the courts that have struck down these disclosure requirements on right to anonymity grounds under the First Amendment have done so in a manner that makes it very unlikely, I think, that the right to anonymous communication will survive at all. There are two doctrinal developments in these cases that I think are particularly disturbing and troubling. First is the courts have said that these disclosure requirements are content neutral, and therefore they only get the sort of wishy-washy, watered-down version of First Amendment scrutiny as opposed to the highest level, the most exacting level of First Amendment scrutiny. They're content neutral in the sense that the anonymity restrictions apply regardless of what it is that someone is actually saying. It's not only political speech or religious speech or commercial speech or any kind of speech. It's all speech. And oddly enough, talk about the doctrine being a mess, because it covers all speech, it gets a lower level of scrutiny than if it covered a subset of speech in which it could, if it was content-based, it would get the highest level of First Amendment scrutiny. So as long as the anonymity restrictions help achieve some important governmental objective, they can be found to be constitutional. The governmental objective in this case is the ability to investigate future crimes. That's what the government asserts is the need for these disclosure rules, for getting all of these internet identifiers. But piercing the veil of anonymity is always going to make it easier for law enforcement to track down and investigate future wrongdoing. If that's all that's required for the government to sustain disclosure requirements, it's very difficult to see any right to be anonymous surviving at all in this age of pervasive government surveillance. If all that's required is for the government to define a class of persons who are statistically more likely than others, perhaps, to commit future crimes, and then to require all of the persons in that class to reveal themselves whenever they communicate as a way to more efficiently investigate future crimes, if that's the rule, I think we're all in trouble. Second, the courts have reached a consensus that the right to communicate anonymously only protects your ability to be anonymous vis-a-vis the public. That is, as long as only the police have the information and don't release it to the public at large, then your right to communicate anonymously has not been abridged, and your free speech rights have not been chilled. This is inexplicable to me. It is thoroughly bizarre. To say that a right to speak anonymously does not protect you against having to reveal your identity to the police in this day and age is equivalent to saying, I think, that you have no such right at all. The Supreme Court has in the past eloquently defended the right to speak anonymously. It has said it is, quote, not a pernicious or fraudulent practice, but an honorable tradition of advocacy and dissent. It exemplifies the purpose behind the First Amendment, to protect individuals from retaliation and to protect their ideas from retaliation at the hands of an intolerant society. The right to be anonymous may be abused, but our society accords greater weight to the value of free speech than to the dangers of its misuse. It's an important tradition, and I hope we can keep it alive. Let me say one quick more thing about this. In all this talk at a conference about global free expression, this may seem a little bit U.S.-centric, and in the greater scheme of things, when people in Bahrain are being thrown in jail for expressing their views and around the world, this may not seem like very much. But it is, of course, more important in a sense for Syrian rebels or Egyptian dissidents or many others in authoritarian states to be anonymous than it is for people in the United States. But many of those people are dependent upon tools that are built in the United States, anonymizing tools that we have distributed around the world, often at government expense, actually, to allow people to express themselves without the fear of surveillance. And the constitutional, if the constitutional defense for anonymity in this country suffers, then I'm afraid that others who are not subject to U.S. law but are dependent upon U.S. technology, maybe dependent upon U.S. technology, their rights to communicate anonymously will suffer as well.
Thank you, David. And I think the corollary to that point is the rest of the world looks to the United States.
Right.
And if we don't set the example, it's not going to happen. I remember going to Yemen to talk about press freedom with the government, happened to land 2 days after Judy Miller had been put in jail for protecting her source. And you can be assured that every conversation I had with the Yemeni government began right there. Yeah. So I'm going to turn to Lynn Oberlander, who's going to talk about a couple of cases dealing with privacy, right of publicity and privacy, which is to say that during our discussion, Lynn drew the short straw and was asked to talk about Hulk Hogan. So.
Well, after talking about Yemen and Syria, this is something a little bit lighter and perhaps more frivolous. But this year, we've seen a continuing battle in the U.S. over really where the right of privacy, if such as it is, melds with the or conflicts with the right to freedom of expression. And I will say that where it seems to be coming out, as it has been looking like it's going to come out, is that the right of privacy in the U.S. belongs to celebrities, and that's pretty much it. Now, I am not a right of publicity person, frankly. I don't think we really should have one, so let me just set that out. This is not a defense of anyone's right of publicity, but to the degree there is a right, I am not sure that it really should just belong to the most powerful as opposed to the least powerful. So there were a couple of interesting things. I want to just mention, I want to talk about two cases. Hulk Hogan, I'm going to end with. But I'm teasing you with Hulk Hogan. I want to start with the Sarver versus Chartier case, which is the Hurt Locker case. Some of you may know about it. It's been around for quite a while. It featured a poor U.S. Army ordnance specialist. And I don't mean poor in the sense of financially poor. I just mean that he has suffered in this and that he was in Iraq. He was defusing bombs. And he was in a unit where Mark Boal was embedded and writing stories. And Mr. Boal saw him, interviewed him in Iraq, took pictures of him, interviewed him back here, wrote a story for Playboy where he took pictures, Sergeant Sarver, was featured prominently in Playboy. Very clear that he was the feature of the story. Mr. Boal then sold his Playboy story to the movies and made the Oscar-winning best film of whatever year it was, The Hurt Locker, in which he changed Sergeant Sarver's name but used lots of elements of his life and then claimed that he didn't do that, that it was just purely a composite, which was obviously not true. In any case, Sarver sued over a number of causes of action, defamation, right of a lot of different rights of privacy, false infliction, emotional distress, and he basically lost at every stage. Without going into the long background, it ended up in California on appeal to the Ninth Circuit on the question of whether the movie folks' anti-SLAPP motion to dismiss the case was going to be affirmed and the case be dismissed. And the Ninth Circuit on February 17th said, basically, yes, we are getting rid of this case. And here's why. I'm not going to give you a primer on Ninth Circuit right of publicity law, but let me just say that it is a disaster. It's all over the place. It does tend to favor celebrities and athletes, and it does tend to not favor the media, or at least entertainment companies. And this was consistent, but there are lots of different strands of rationales and reasoning here, and I know there are people in this audience who can explain it much more succinctly than this. But what the Ninth Circuit did in this case was that they basically said, this movie was core protected speech, which is a good thing, right? That this First Amendment speech, this is art, this deserves high protection. And so against that, Sarver's claim under the California right of publicity statute could only stand if it served a compelling government interest. And what the Ninth Circuit said was that they looked at all of their cases and they basically said that the only compelling government interest that justifies a right of publicity statute, in their mind, is the one that protects the, and I'm reading this here, that protects the economic value that some plaintiffs may have built in their reputations, be it as a television star or as a professional athlete. That's not a quote. This is the quote. In sum, our precedents have held that speech which either appropriates the economic value of a performance or a persona or seeks to capitalize off a celebrity's image in commercial advertisements is unprotected by the First Amendment against a California right of publicity claim. So it's unprotected speech, the speech which either appropriates the economic value of a performance or a persona or seeks to capitalize off a celebrity's image in commercial advertisements is unprotected by the First Amendment against a right of publicity claim. So it was kind of a backward statement, but it was pretty explicit. Like, that is what the right of publicity protects and that it overrides the First Amendment in California. So poor Mr. Sarver, who did not get paid for his life story, unlike everybody else, and who did not profit from this movie, because his case claims were completely dismissed, because he is not a football player, he's not Paris Hilton, and he's not any of the other celebrities in California who have succeeded on their rights of publicity cases. So that's the first case. It's still a mess, right of publicity law in California and everywhere else. The next case, which, you know, which I know everyone wants to hear about, although you've probably read more than you want to hear about, is the Hulk Hogan case. And I'll just, assuming that most people understand what happened here, he's filmed, there was a less than two minute excerpt of the sex tape, the 30 minute sex tape, Gawker ran it. 9 seconds in that 2 minutes excerpted tape was sort of explicit conduct, sexual conduct. The rest of it was, you know, blurry people talking, walking around, not that interesting. In fact, the whole thing's not that interesting if you see it. It was accompanied by a lengthy written prose piece that the editor of Gawker put up there, which if you also have read it, and if not, it's still up, you can read that, is incredibly explicit, all right? And fairly gratuitous, but that's there. The parties to this case agreed. Oh my God, I can't believe I've got only 2 minutes left. All right, but the parties to this case agreed that the prose piece was newsworthy. So that was not at issue in the trial. They went to trial, lots of procedural problems, lots of things going on over whether or not the video itself was newsworthy, because I think there wasn't too much of a doubt that it did have some highly personal information in it in the nine seconds, and that some people might find, you know, offensive to have put on the internet. So then the question under the tort is, but was it newsworthy? And several courts in advance of the trial had held that this very tape was newsworthy and was protected. But the trial judge disagreed, went to trial. As you know, the $140 million verdict against Gawker and Nick Denton. Now, this is an aside, but Aaron Andrews, sportscaster, had a sex tape case that went to verdict just a month before, perhaps, before the Gawker case. And she was only awarded $60 million. So query, and in Canada, in Paul's presentation, there is a sex tape case where the plaintiff, again a woman, was only awarded $100,000. So, you know, I actually think there is some gender, there's some gender bias as well in the verdict to begin with. But it is a, so there was a $140 million verdict. Today, the Gawker's post-trial briefs were supposed to be filed. I assume they were. I haven't seen them yet. We think there'll be a motion for remitter, probably a judgment notwithstanding the verdict, all sorts of, you know, procedural errors alleged. And then we'll see what happens. If the trial judge denies their motion, as is possible, maybe even probable given their history, they will then, and there will also be a motion to reduce the bond. The bond is capped under Florida law at $50 million, but it's $50 million, and that's
before you can appeal.
The appeal bond is capped at $50 million, and you really, you know, it's not one of these bonds, because I've asked, where you can put up $5 million and get this $50 million bond. They ostensibly have to put up $50 million, and if that bond is not reduced, either by the trial judge or by the appellate judge, I'm assuming Gawker will try on both of them. Gawker has said that it faces sort of an existential threat, that it doesn't have $50 million to put up this bond. And I actually think that this is, frankly, what we should be looking at, which is there, and I think there might be, and I think this, my organization will help, you know, organize around this if anyone's here is interested, but is there a First Amendment problem with the size of the bond such that you can't even get to an appeal when there's actually, you know, very good reason to think that you might be successful on an appeal? Does this itself, the size of the bond itself, present constitutional problems? Which, you know, I think it does, but I'd really be curious to hear what folks think here. To sum up, I mean, which is really where I started, you know, we have a system here where we are clearly struggling with the confines of the right of privacy insofar as it interferes with the freedom of expression. And I know for the Europeans here, you guys will say, well, you should be struggling with this. but it is a, we're struggling with it, but we are really only protecting so far the privacy of really the powerful, which I would suggest is not where we want to be. So thanks.
Thank you. The maybe even more thankless task given to Paul was to encapsulate the entirety of Canadian law in 8 minutes. But he's taken that on, and we'll hit some of the highlights. And during the conversation, we'll get back to the points that we don't get to in the presentation. So, Paul?
Sure. Well, thank you, David. Although, having been introduced as being from the 51st state, I think I'm going to ask Agnes to put me back on the Latin American panel, which is where I was last year. It says USA on my name tag as well, but you know, we're used to that up in Canada, where it's, living next to the elephant and feeling its sneezes and sniffles. But it's actually, there's not, you know, the question we were asked was what big cases have there been in Canada, and there actually hasn't been very much this year, frankly. We're much more excited in Canada, as I think a lot of people are, about the fact that we've come out of the dark age of the last 10 years of a Conservative government, and we have a new Trudeau who is the most surprised people in the world are the Canadians, actually, by this guy. We all thought he was a lightweight, and maybe he is, but he's really got everybody excited, and he's very progressive, and with the echoes of Obama, I think his first day in power, sent out a similar message about access to information, for example, and said it's time to turn it around and become more transparent, and we're going to do a whole review of our access to information laws, and it's about time. He has a majority government, and he might actually succeed, but you never know when it's all going to turn and we're going to get cynical. There are a few things I do want to tell you of interest as to what's going on in Canada. And for those of you who aren't that familiar with our very large but very small country, we are quite different from the United States. Our legal roots are, of course, firmly based in English law and English common law, except that unlike England, we adopted a Charter of Rights in the early 80s based on modern international covenants on human rights. And so we've now got 35 years of experience and our own interpretations of these provisions, which I think makes us somewhat unique because we're also not bound by international courts as the UK is, for example, with the European Court of Human Rights. And so we do have the ability to go our own way. So I just want to talk about three things. The first is defamation, just to come back to some of the discussion this morning. We've had a responsible journalism, we call it a responsible communication defense, since 2009. It's a broader defense, deliberately designed or stated to be responsible communication as opposed to responsible journalism. Excuse me. So it's more all-encompassing than simply the protection of investigative journalism, which is how it was developed in England. Our concept of public interest is very wide, to address Mr. Glasser's point this morning around public interest, and we'll see where that takes us. But I think when we talk about norms, this is an interesting issue for, you know, why is it that we and the UK and now some of the other Commonwealth countries have developed this middle ground defense in defamation law? I don't think it's because we felt pulled there by New York Times and Sullivan. That may have had some influence, but I think it's more the fact that in Canada and in the UK, we've now got to reckon with and be bound by international documents that constitutionalize free expression, but also reflect a balancing. And that's what makes us so different, in a way, from the First Amendment in the United States, where there's no balancing, it's just all one side. Interest issue is now interesting because Ontario has just adopted an anti-slap law. There's been one in Quebec, but it has had little impact. But Ontario is the largest province in Canada, and we're quite excited that there may now be a way to hopefully bring an early resolution to a lot of defamation claims at an early stage. At least on paper, it looks like a pretty strong statute. It's only been in effect for 2 months, so I don't have any jurisprudence to tell you about, but we'll be watching for it, so maybe stay tuned for next year. Secondly, privacy. We may not be Americans, but we say privacy, not privacy. We don't really have much jurisprudence, interestingly, on the common law tort of privacy. We've been waiting for years for it to jump the ponds, as I say, whether it's the Atlantic Ocean or Lake Ontario, to get into Canada. Our privacy has largely been limited to legislative privacy, such as data protection laws and privacy in the context of access to information legislation. But that is now changing. We've had a number of decisions in the last few years that have opened the door to at least open the door a crack to torts of privacy, intrusion upon seclusion, to use the old American concepts, public disclosure of embarrassing private facts, have both been recognized to a limited extent, and I think that's going to grow. I don't think we can ignore it anymore, and people are looking for ways to raise these concerns when libel, frankly, has become less and less of a weapon by plaintiffs for speech, largely because of the responsible communication defense. Similarly, we are seeing the beginnings of a debate about the right to be forgotten, which is a little troubling. The Privacy Commissioner, the Federal Privacy Commissioner, has just issued a discussion paper on online reputation that is squarely raised the question of whether the right to be forgotten should be incorporated into Canadian law. And I should say that map you saw on the law, that's incorrect on Canada too. I think there's some confusion because there is one case that I do want to mention from the past year that is quite significant, and it was mentioned this morning, is the Equistuck case, if I'm pronouncing it right. It's a lawsuit involving trade secrets and trademark, breach of trade secrets and trademarks out of British Columbia, where Google was brought in as a third party and was ordered to delist all of the references to the websites anywhere in the world that might be publishing these trademarks and trade secrets. And that's the concern. I think that's why people are mistaking it for thinking we've got a right to be forgotten. And so it's we haven't gotten there yet, but there's clearly a concern about that type of order, which of course smacks of what is being faced in Europe. So Equistuck has just been granted leave to appeal to the Supreme Court of Canada, so it may be in a year or so we'll have a decision on that, but that may, at least for now, is giving some, causing some concerns, and I see a few nods around the room, so people are clearly watching that. The last point I just want to come back to, which is freedom of information. As I said, Prime Minister Trudeau has called for a review of that. Canada wasn't that far behind the U.S. in bringing in access to information laws. The federal laws were brought in the 70s. We thought we were a trailblazer. We've become, I think, really an outlier, kind of like the Americans in that area, too, in the last 15 or 20 years. Dave may talk or mention it. We have a limited derivative constitutional right to information, which is doesn't make any sense to me at all, that you have a right of access where it's necessary to permit meaningful discussion on matters of public concern. But of course, how do you know that unless you can get the information? And so we're hoping that that will change. One other point, and it may touch on what Dave Schulz is going to talk about too, and I think it's a new battle that we're dealing with, which is the conflict between access to information and privacy laws and access to courts, and in particular administrative tribunals. We have a pretty robust openness principle in Canada. In some ways it's both less and more robust than actually is in the United States, but we're having a problem because all of the government judicial tribunals that have been matters that have been taken out of courts are subject to FOI legislation, which means there's no openness at all. You want to find out about something that happens at the Labor Board or the Human Rights Tribunal, all these things that are residential housing tribunals and so on that all used to be in the courts. You can't find it out unless you have to make a freedom of information request, and then you're into the nightmare of freedom of information. So there are battles looming in that area in Canada, and I'd be interested to, after Dave speaks, about the experience in the United States. So that's a quick snapshot. Thank you.
Thank you. And finally, Dave Schulz is going to talk about the First Amendment right of access to government proceedings 36 years after Richmond newspapers We're still kind of exploring the frontiers, I guess, on that.
Expanding the frontiers.
Expanding the frontiers on that.
Yeah, I think by the time I'm done, you're going to really wish the last panel was still up here, because they had a nice coherent topic that they could look at from different areas of the world, and it all kind of made sense, and they could talk about. This is kind of like, you know, the old story about a group of blind people in a room try to define an elephant by each touching it in one spot. So here we are talking about free expression, and everybody's talking about something different, but I'm going to take it in a different direction too. But it's I just want to put into the space this whole issue of the constitutional right of access and what's kind of where it stands in the United States, because I think that one of the things we learned from the Snowden disclosures is that technology has fundamentally changed the relationship between governments and citizens in really dramatic ways that are only just now sinking in. You know, we've never before lived in a society where a government, if it wanted to, could essentially know everything that someone was saying all the time, that they have that power and that they're willing to use it. And I think one of the most important ways we need to think about as citizens of counteracting that is having legal rights to compel the government to tell us what it's up to. And that's why the constitutional right of access in the United States, it's a First Amendment right, and I'll just talk a little bit about it, is really important, because it's unlike the freedom of information laws that can be changed, that have exceptions. It's a constitutional right that was first recognized in this country in 1980. Lee Bollinger, in his most recent book, highlighted this, put a spotlight on it as a really important right that needs to be further developed and needs to be developed internationally. It was the notion of a right to certain types of government information was first recognized internationally in, I think, 1998 or 99 in the Reyes case in the Inter-American Court. There have been a couple of decisions since then in the European Court of Human Rights, and more recently in Canada. But let me just tell you a little bit about what's happening currently in the United States on this right, and why I think it's such an important right, and looking at it from two different directions. The right in this country evolved from the right of access to courts. There was a lot of litigation in the 1970s here about whether there was some sort of First Amendment right to require the government to give over information. It was a huge issue in the aftermath of the Vietnam War, where people believed they'd been lied to, in the aftermath of Watergate, where there was a lot of deception and government abuse. And there were many efforts to get this recognized as a right, and most of them were unsuccessful in the context of saying we have a right to know what's going on in prisons, or we have a right to know what's going on in mental hospitals and other places. But in 1980, in a case out of Virginia, a court recognized it, that there is a constitutional right to know what's going on in courts, and it was first defined as a right of access to government proceedings that the court said was implicit in the other First Amendment rights. If you have a right to speak, you have a right to a free press, you have a freedom of association, you have the right to petition the government. Those are rights you can't exercise if you don't also have the right of access to certain fundamental, in this case it was government proceedings. And the court was very reluctant to expand the right broadly. It talked about it as a right to proceedings. It said we're going to define where the right comes by looking at history, if there's a long history of access to this type of government proceeding, and also by looking at what they call the logic, the policy of allowing access. So that was the beginning of it. In the last 36 years, there's been a lot of litigation, and since I only have about 4 minutes left, I'm not going to go through it all, but expanding it in the courts, and it's now pretty widely accepted that there is a constitutional right to almost every court proceeding, and also just as broadly or almost as broadly accepted that right also extends to the records of court proceedings. So you actually have a constitutional right. Now, it's not an absolute right. It can be overcome, but it's a very high standard. In essence, you have to show that to deny the public a right of access to either a court proceeding or a court record, that there is some compelling governmental interest that will be harmed by allowing access, and that there's no other way to protect that governmental interest. So it's an important right, and where it's being litigated now, it's in two ways. One is sort of in the national security area and in the aftermath of 9/11, this right has become very important, and there's been a lot of battles over the extent to which the government can make certain information secret on national security grounds and whether there is any tool to fight back on it. Where is it being litigated now? In a couple contexts. One is in court. There was a decision last year by the, or just a year and a half ago, by the District Court in the District of Columbia that was in the D.C. Circuit last year, that raised the following question. There is a Guantanamo detainee named Ziad Dihab, a Yemeni who was, I think he was Yemeni, who was being held in Guantanamo. He had been approved for release 4 years after he was approved for release, and he was still there. He started a hunger strike. 3 months after he started the hunger strike, the government started forced feeding him, pulling him out of his cell, shoving a tube down his nose twice a day, and feeding him. His lawyers had a habeas proceeding pending in the District of Columbia. They went in for an injunction claiming that this force feeding constituted cruel and unusual punishment, violated international treaties, and amounted to torture. In the course of litigating that, the government disclosed that it actually had videotapes of these force feeding proceedings. It had 32 videotapes. They had a fight about whether the government had to turn them over to the Diab's lawyers so that he could see them, because they were classified. The court required them to be turned over, and of course, the first thing Diab's lawyers does is say, okay, judge, here they are. We're going to offer them into evidence because this is proof of what we're saying is the cruel and unusual punishment. They are accepted into evidence without objection from the government, but filed under seal. Next thing that happens, because we have this constitutional right of access, is a group of news organizations go running into court and saying, these are court records. We have a constitutional right to see them. So here's the conflict. The records, these videotapes, have been classified by the executive branch. The president and the whole defense agencies have said, these are classified. It's important for national security purposes that they not be released. They are court records. The media is there saying, you, judge, have to decide whether to release them. The president is saying, no, you don't have the right to decide. I have the right to decide because it's a national security issue. And that's the issue that's being litigated. The judge, in a very brave decision, I think, said, no, when they come into court, they become court records, the constitutional right applies, and therefore the government has to meet the constitutional standard. It doesn't mean they become public. She made the government put in evidence to explain why they thought they were harmed to national security, and she found the evidence insufficient. That issue is now before the D.C. Circuit, and it's being briefed. The media brief went in last week. There's one more round of briefing, and it'll be argued in September. So that's one to watch, but it's very important. The same issue is playing out in the Guantanamo military commissions, where the similar issue comes up. There's a lot of classified information there. The issue is what happens to it, and it's an issue. So that's one way the right is important. The other way is the right has been expanded out in more recent years beyond the courts. Judges have recognized that this analysis that the Supreme Court went through looking to history and logic means that the same right should apply in many other areas. It has been held to apply to deportation proceedings, which are not judicial proceedings. They, at the time of 9/11, the immigration hearings were all conducted by the Department of Justice, their administrative hearings. It's now done by the Department of Homeland Security. But the same constitutional right has been held to apply there. It's been held to apply to administrative proceedings here in New York. If you jump the subway, break into the subway, or you play your radio too loud in the subway, you don't go to criminal court. You go to an administrative hearing for a fine. Those are open. And where it's being litigated now, and I'll just end with this, the expansion of it, is in an area where you see the intersection with freedom of information laws. In this country, there are, I think, 14 or 15 states that still have a death penalty. In every state that has the death penalty, the current method of execution is by lethal injection. Over the last 5 or 6 years, partly driven by Europe, drug companies have started to insist that their drugs not be used by corrections departments for purposes of killing people. And that has led every state that still does lethal injection executions to decide they are no longer going to say where they get their drugs. In many states, they've changed their freedom of information laws so it can't happen, or they've reinterpreted them to say that this can properly be withheld. So what's being litigated now in Arizona in a couple cases, one that went to the Ninth Circuit a year ago and was vacated on some other grounds, but there's two now in Arizona, taking the same argument that there is a First Amendment constitutional right of the public to know the source of the drugs that are used in executions, because the public has, the logic goes, you have a right of access to the execution itself. It is a government proceeding. There's a history of access. In this country, hangings were always, the public executions were always public. that you have a right to know the means of execution, because it's the only way that society can know whether it constitutes cruel and unusual punishment and can exercise democratic oversight. And where the means of execution is lethal injection drugs, the only way to know their effectiveness and their quality and everything else is to know who made them. And what's happened in the last couple of years, there has been some horrendous cases of botched executions where drugs were used and it took 2 or 2.5 hours for the death, and they were very ugly things. So that this argument is gaining traction, and it's another way that this constitutional right becomes important, because it is a counterweight to legislative action. And I'll just stop there.
Thank you, Dave. Before we go, let me just ask one. Let me take the moderator's privilege and ask my one question, and then get to yours. And that is, you know, as I sit here listening to this and listening to what we've heard today, and I think all of us have the same feeling that you're talking about sort of the expansion of First Amendment free expression rights into areas that may strike many as trivial compared to people being put in jail for their beliefs and so forth in other countries. But it does raise the question, as I hear about the various cases, and I'm going to speak here as a representative of old line media, are we in jeopardizing First Amendment freedom by all of these, by making law about unpopular speech and unpopular speakers? Should I feel that all of the great First Amendment precedents that were established when mainstream media roamed the earth like dinosaurs is now being threatened because we're asking for really hard stuff, whether it's sex offenders, whether it's trademarks that deal with what may be offensive speech, Hulk Hogan's privacy for sex tapes, and so forth. So go for it.
Well, I would just say in a very general way that I do think that how the law develops depends a lot upon the context of the times. And a lot of what you described is the great cases, the decisions we got, the Pentagon Papers case and New York Times versus Sullivan, they arose at a time, and particularly the access cases I talked about, the reporter's privilege case, a lot of the constitutional principles that developed in this country developed in the aftermath of Watergate and the Vietnam War, and at a time when the public generally really understood the value of an independent media. And in today's environment, that whole situation has switched. There has been years and years of criticism of the media, complaints that they're biased, general distrust, and we're in a post 9/11 atmosphere where people are very, very concerned about security, and so that the whole zeitgeist has changed. And I think that that affects the judiciary just as it affects the rest of society.
David.
Yeah, and I think add to that what the theme that has come up earlier today, that the technology fundamentally changes the balance. You don't have to be the New York Times anymore to be the New York Times, you know, or pretend to be the New York Times, actually. I mean, you can the number of voices in the public debate has multiplied the orders of magnitude, which is means good speech and bad. So we're surrounded by I think a new landscape that has many people either frightened or angry, and I don't think we have come to rest yet in terms of how that's going to. The First Amendment has to adjust to that some way, and I just don't think we have yet really come to terms with how that's going to work.
I actually disagree with the notion that we're like in the sui generis time. I don't think technology has really changed anything here, and I think that in that you look at the Brandeis, the original privacy paper is 1890, and people felt their privacy was directly and very horribly infringed, and they didn't need the internet to feel that way. And similarly, if you look at, you look at any of even the cases from 1919 or going back, we had a lot of speech. We had a lot of independent newspapers at the time of the founding of this country. We had anonymous speech. We had hateful things being written about, all sorts of really, really atrocious, defamatory things written about everybody who even thought about entering the public sphere. I think maybe it's just that it's changed in the last 35 years. You know, there was one swing, and now we're swinging back. But I'm hesitant to say that the rise of the internet has changed really anything here, that we should be,
And the only thing I'd add is I don't think it's uncommon for the cases raising individual speech rights to involve very unpopular speech. I think that's just been a consistent in First Amendment jurisprudence. And The Slants case represents sort of an interesting twist on that, because the Slants say they want to use a slur to reclaim it. And, you know, whether that has any relevance to the doctrine, I think as a matter of sort of public perception, they've made the argument that, you know, language can't evolve, it can't change, there can't be a dialogue if we sort of take a hardline view about what's offensive speech or not. So I don't think it's unusual, and I think those are the hard cases that have implications for everyone.
Well, let me sort of do a follow-up on that, and this came up a little bit in some prior panels. Should we be making a distinction between the press clause and the speech clause, which has not been part of American jurisprudence, really? And I mean, should we be trying to protect speech that deals with the stuff that the dinosaur media cover, politics, government, and so forth? And is there a threat to what I think has been sort of the driving factor behind the old cases, the need to be covering news and have opinion about news, as opposed to some of the things we're talking about now? I mean, is there any viability in sort of saying, okay, the speech clause should be interpreted differently from the press clause?
Whoa! I was gonna jump in, but the way you're implying that it would be different is not how I would conceive
it. Well, go
of it.
For it. I had a brief discussion
with the last panel. I do think that the press clause has viability and has meaning independent of the speech clause, and it's not just how big an audience you reach. That the press clause, I believe, should properly be understood to recognize the protection of certain types of activity that are fundamental to the dissemination of information. In other words, speech lets you disseminate, publish, broadcast what you know. The press clause protects those types of activities that we might call news gathering. And it's not a class of people who are individual, it's a function that is protected. And that hasn't been very well developed in the law. I couldn't cite you cases that say that that's what the Constitution means, but I think there's been a lot of work by a professor at Georgia called Sonia West about this, showing the history of this and making some of these arguments. But I think it's important to a full understanding of freedom of expression. And if I could take one...
Before you go there, though, isn't it much harder today than it was 30 years ago to figure out who is in that category?
I think that it certainly was easier when you knew who everybody had a press pass,
right?
And you knew we had three networks and we had, you know, two newspapers in every town at least, and now all we have is the New York Times everywhere. It's harder, but there's, I think, you know, the Congress over the last few years was struggling to come up with a reporter's privilege law. And it was really dealing with this issue. It was like, how do you define who's eligible for this privilege? And I think ultimately the way you define it is by functionality. What is your intention? What are you going to do with the information? Why are you collecting it? It's not an easy line drawing, but I think it's the type of line drawing courts do all the time.
And what you were going to put a footnote on?
Oh, I was just going to say, I, the reason I think it's important is that, and this is going to take us off into the twilight zone, I'm afraid, but as technology is evolving, you know, that more and more, there are people now who have, you know, embedded chips in their arms that, you know, we all saw Google Glass, it didn't go anywhere, but we're not too far away from the day when you will physically have the capability to wander around during the day and everything that you see will be saved in a database, right? What are the implications for that for First Amendment doctrine? Is that database yours? Can someone else use it? Is it protected? Do you have the right to record everything you see, right? You have a right to look. You know, nobody would say you don't have a protected right to walk into a room and look around unless, you know, you're trespassing or something. But do you have the right to record that? And there are a lot of technology-driven questions that are going to become very important, for which we need to have a clear understanding of what are the scopes of the rights and why do they exist.
Yeah. Before we go to the audience here, Paul, do you want to reflect on any of this from a Canadian standpoint? Is their protection of coarse speech different?
Well, we don't differentiate between free speech and a press clause. Mm-hmm. the media have no special rights different from anybody else. Having said that, we do have a limited recognition of news gathering principles and the special role of the media, which can protect it, I think, more so in the news gathering situation than in any other. But it's not, there's no sort of a doctrine out there that that you would talk about in American law.
All right, Sandy, start.
Well, I wanted to raise a case that I thought was exceptionally important. An exceptionally important case last year, and actually ties into the right of publicity, and that is Reed v. Town of Gilbert. It seems to me that the Supreme Court talked in the broadest, or a collection of a number of the broadest terms possible for defining what kind of speech would get strict scrutiny. That is the highest level of scrutiny under the First Amendment. Compelling state interest would have to be shown to uphold the law or regulation. And any rule that impinges on it has to be cast as narrowly as possible in order to meet that compelling need. And the court went so far, and we'll see if they actually mean it as time goes on, to say something to the effect that if in evaluating a claim under a law or regulation, you have to look at the content of the speech, then the speech is content-based and subject to strict scrutiny. Now, as many of you know, many in the academy at least, and I know a lot in industry, are looking at the town of Gilbert combined with a prior case, Sorrell, which involved the question of whether commercial speech gets as much protection as non-commercial speech, or at least that came up in the language of the decision, to see whether they can effectively render much of what we think of as regulation in this country of speech under food and drug laws, perhaps under the SEC, and other parts of what we think of as the post-New Deal or the New Deal regulatory state. And that, I think, has huge potential consequences for all aspects, certainly, of American life. But on right of publicity, what it meant was that Sarver decision is the first time I'm aware of that a court in this country, using the Reed decision as its basis, forced itself to look at right of publicity under strict scrutiny. And so as someone who is on a campaign to undo right of publicity, I've been running around urging people to use Reed all over the country in order to undo right of publicity. But I view it as one of the most consequential First Amendment cases, certainly of the last year. And perhaps your panel just disagrees, but I wanted to throw it in the hopper.
We had an interesting discussion of it, but it decided not to take it on here, so we're glad that you did so well. Yes, please. Yes, you.
Yes, I'm Thais from Brazil, and I don't know, Paul, why you've been moved from our Latin America panel. We will miss you, yes, tomorrow. But I was just wondering, asking you in your countries if you have the discussion if the right to be forgotten is not, in fact, the right to be de-indexed. I think that in Brazil, at least, we have a lot of discussions about the real problem is to be indexed in Google, for example. That's why, if you have these issues in your countries.
Well, I think, as I said, we're having that debate. We haven't really had it in the courts yet, but we are having that debate. I wish we would call it the right to be de-indexed, or maybe not even the right to be de-indexed, de-indexing requests or something, but get it away from this language, because I think the right to be forgotten is something that resonates with a lot of people in a way that really is inconsistent with free expression.
Yes, just because the Gonzalez versus Spain, the case Google. In fact, it was the right to be de-indexed. The decision was about being indexed and not to be forgotten, because the original publication was maintained. So that's why I was just asking.
I always thought we all were afraid of being forgotten, so.
here and then in the back.
I have a question, Dirk Foro from Belgium. A question on, I would like to pick on the observation which was made on the right of anonymity, that you said the situation is blurring and we should have a high standard in the United States because the whole world is looking at us. I think this perception is stronger in the United States than in other words, or the United States. But it brings me to my question, because in Europe we have quite high standards on protection of journalistic sources and whistleblowing. And my question is, are there developments with regard to First Amendment protection on these two issues?
Not much in the last year. The last big development there was when the Fourth Circuit, in the Jim Risen case, I guess 3 years ago now, basically said there's no constitutional right, there's no common law right, period. I'm certain that's not the last word. I don't think other circuits are going to follow that. I think someday the Supreme Court will have to take it, but there has not been much in the way of litigation on that front where there's been definitive.
What?
Go ahead.
No, what there has been is that there's been a General Petraeus was found to have also distributed confidential classified information without permission, and he, unlike all of the whistleblowers, got off without any jail time. And I think the public and the judiciary took notice of that, so that you have actually seen a somewhat of a reduction in sentences The people are less inclined to bring those cases now.
Let's go all the way back right there and then over here. Yes, please.
My name is Shushu. Should we consider that the fact the US spied on communication of other figures' countries, is that a lack of freedom of expression?
I'm sorry. Yes.
Can you repeat that?
Yeah, could you repeat that? We didn't quite catch it.
I think it was the question.
The fact that the U.S. spied on communication of other countries.
Well, Paul, you get a pass, and all the rest of you have to speak today.
I think it's an ACLU question. Right.
Well, you know, I think I can give you an example of one case in the United States where we raised the argument that that type of surveillance, the sort of wholesale collection of information about people's communications, can chill speech. It's a case out of Mississippi where the Mississippi Attorney General, so the state's law enforcement officer, served a subpoena on Google, essentially asking Google to turn over all, you know, YouTube posts, posts on Google Plus, email communications with people who had made these posts, just a very wide sweeping subpoena, intending to sort of sweep in a range of communications that the Attorney General was interested in and covering clearly protected speech. You know, the Attorney General said any dangerous speech, which would include discussions or depictions of soccer or football, because that fell within the definition of dangerous speech. And the ACLU filed an amicus brief in that case saying that we should be very concerned about that type of surveillance, even though the information might be made publicly, an investigator could look at this, but the ability to draw connections and to know who had said what when they might have expected to be anonymous, and also just, you know, an individual's knowledge that anything that they do through a Google service might end up in the hands of a law enforcement officer could chill speech. So I think there's a connection there, and, I don't think We sort of focused on the broad surveillance and the anonymity aspects because there were, the subpoena would potentially reveal the names of parties that you could not have not otherwise found from the public-facing information. But we did draw that connection there.
Yeah, I just would add, I mean, it's a very good question. The history in this country has largely been that surveillance law has fallen under, has been examined as a privacy, the Fourth Amendment, your protection against unreasonable searches and unreasonable seizures of property and all that. And I think that more recently there's sort of an attempt at least to express this more as a First Amendment freedom of speech, freedom of expression problem, that if the that what's wrong with the government surveillance, widespread government surveillance, is not just that you're doing a performing a search on my information without a warrant, but that you are, the knowledge that you're doing that is chilling my ability to speak, all of our ability to speak freely. So that connection, I think, is being made and will continue to be made, because I think that's at the heart of the issues that people are concerned with in the surveillance state, as it were.
Thank you. I just would like to follow up on the whistleblower journalist sources issue on the comment Lynn made. Actually, there's one whistleblower who is in jail right now. It's Jeffrey Sterling, the alleged source of James Risen, and he has been sentenced to almost 3 years in life. So I'm still focusing on this issue, obviously. But actually, my main question is on Canada. And Mr. Schabas, I would be very interested to hear your views on last week Ontario Superior Court ruling that asked the Vice News reporter Ben McCrush to hand over all his communication with his source, ISIS fighter. So I'm very curious to hear your views on that.
Well, it's a very, glad you raised it, it's a very troubling decision. So a reporter from Vice exchanged a lot of communications using something called Kik with a young Canadian who then went off to join ISIS in Syria or Iraq. It's not clear where he is, and the police are investigating this and sought a production order to have him turn over all of his communications. And it's a very troubling decision. It's hopefully it's a one-off. I know the judge. He's a former Crown. He's not a very sympathetic judge when it comes to the media. And he gave no weight at all to the concerns around the chilling effects on the journalist, and didn't even mention the evidence that was led in the case on that. So it's a bad decision. It's further amplified, and this may make it yet a good case to take on appeal, because the judge then also ordered sealed about half of the affidavit in support of the production order. Which makes no sense at all, and he did so on the basis that it might jeopardize the accused's fair trial rights if they can ever find him and bring him back to Canada. It's an absolutely absurd decision and inconsistent with the whole weight of jurisprudence in that area in the last 10 years in Canada.
Yes, please. Yeah, just a very brief comment to vigorously support what Thais was saying regarding not using the expression right to be forgotten. Please, this is something that I've been saying at the last conference, and it's an ongoing battle. We haven't found the right replacement, and I like the fact that you suggest using de-indexing or de-listing requests rather than even the right to be de-indexed, but please don't use this expression. It's inaccurate. Thank you.
Hi, Kerry Shankman with the Center for Constitutional Rights, and we represent WikiLeaks and Julian Assange, argued and won his case in the UN 2 months ago. And actually, to your question earlier, I forgot who asked, but just less than 2 weeks ago, the DOJ confirmed in a federal court filing that after 6 years, there's still an active and ongoing national security case against WikiLeaks. So that's definitely relevant to everyone in this room. But my question, actually taking a step back, goes to the anonymity point, which I think is really interesting at the intersection of technology. And there's an interesting case actually in February where a Washington judge held that there is no reasonable expectation of privacy in using Tor. And as folks in this room might know, Tor is a anonymity service where your internet traffic gets routed through a proxy. So basically you get the website doesn't know where your internet traffic is coming from, and the whole point of using Tor is for anonymity. But I'm kind of curious for folks on the panel where you see the role of technology for anonymity, because you had this Washington judge coming forward in a very surprising ruling saying that there was no expectation of privacy in Tor, and coming forward, whether you expect other courts to adopt that trend, or if you saw that more as an aberration.
I do think that the encryption debate is heating up, obviously, because of developments in the Apple versus FBI case that happened recently. And even though those issues weren't centered on anonymity or freedom of expression, I think the fight for encryption is squarely at the heart of this question of, you know, how can technology preserve freedom of expression? How can technology be a tool to allow for anonymous speech in, you know, an age of mass surveillance? And so I think, you know, I think that debate is ongoing right now, and I'm sure that the, you know, implications on speech will become more clear as Congress may soon debate legislation that would impact encryption and whether, you know, technology companies can provide strong end-to-end encryption.
Right. I heartily second the idea that this is the beginning, really. The encryption battle has been sort of percolating quietly for the last many years, obviously has now in many more people's consciousness. I think it is very closely related to the sort of First Amendment question about whether or not you have a right, you have a right to be anonymous, whether the government can suppress the tools that are used to enable you to be anonymous, as in the password protect feature of the Apple phone or the Tor network. I think it was an aberration in the sense that other courts are not going to feel bound to follow this particular precedent, but I do think there's going to be a very vigorous debate over the constitutional standing of these tools over the next, whatever, 5 to 10 years or so.
Somebody want to ask the last question before we ask the panel if they want to have a last word here? Anybody want a last word here? Anybody want to talk about Apple and whether it's compelled speech?
I would just say the one thing that it struck me, Sandy was saying we didn't talk about, the other thing I think is a big development that we didn't touch on, that one of the earlier panels, is this whole notion of you know, the right not to be offended. I think there's a huge issue in going on in schools in this country about the relationship between free speech and people's feelings, and whether they have a right not to hear certain things or be confronted with certain things, which is a huge issue, and I think we'll be seeing more of that in the year ahead.
Yeah, and I think, you know, and Sandy was right to raise Reed, because it is an important decision. I think we have a hard time understanding whether it's going to be a giver of gifts or a giver of misery, because it's going to be used to challenge consumer protection, financial regulation, all those kind of things. That, I think a lot of us think, bad. If it takes out the right of publicity, we think, that's not so bad. Unless you're a Hollywood celebrity. But anyway, thank you very much. I appreciate it.